Welcome to the Seahawkers Podcast with your host, Adam Emmert.
You got to give the people what they want.
And Brandon Schultz.
Be sure to tell us when it is so we can continue to have Seahawks fans harass you.
Go Hawks!
This is the Seahawkers Podcast. I'm Brandon Schultz of the Military Seahawkers. And joining me, my good buddy and Montana Seahawker, Adam Emmert.
How's it going, buddy? Back on the regular platform, I guess, today.
Yeah, we're switching back and forth, although I think we need to talk a little bit about what our plans are moving forward, because as we launched the Field Goals Podcast last week under the new feed, we had some questions rolling in, and I think we'll probably need to get to those.
Yeah, let's do that for sure. But we have a special treat for everybody today.
Yeah, we do. We have some losers coming on the show.
That's right. Well, they're like, they won a little more than us, but they didn't win at all.
Yes. Yeah. Well, and, you know, there are losers coming on the show with a couple of losers. It just depends on how you define it, because,
right,
yes, their team may have lost the Super Bowl, but individually, they won their bets over us losers. To start the season, the Rams podcast, James and Bear, they're going to be coming up on the show and we're going to be talking to them.
We're going to have to get this bet thing out of the way, right out of the gate.
Yeah. I don't want it hanging over us anymore.
No.
We lost. Let's move on.
Exactly.
Get over it. Mine was a little bit closer, although not very exciting to watch throughout the season. Well, I'm sure we'll get into that with those guys.
Yeah. You guys might as well have been betting on a glacier.
Yeah. How many inches with this glacier move in
until
the
until it calves?
Yes, not super exciting, but it is the off season. And before we get into the interview, let's talk about one thing that's kind of swirling around in the trade rumor mill this last week. And I wanted to get your thoughts on this, Adam, because the rumor surrounding
I'll stop. It's bullshit.
Catfish.
It is.
Sure. I don't even know what it is yet, but
rumor is BS
for the most part. All right. What's the rumor?
The idea that Odell Beckham could be available via trade, that's floating around out there.
Okay.
Would you give up? Because I think both of us are in on the same idea. We don't want Le'Veon Bell. We don't want Antonio Brown, former Steelers. They're out. Beckham is a little bit intriguing, though. And we've talked about it that we wouldn't be opposed to the idea of the Seahawks taking a wide receiver with their first round pick. Mm-hmm. If they were able to get Beckham for a 2019 first rounder, a 2020 third rounder, and let's say you have to throw in Doug Baldwin, do you make that deal for Beckham?
Is that even a serious question?
I don't know.
I mean, you really? Hell no.
No?
All the no's forever no.
Really?
Huh. Oh my God, yes. Why in God's green earth would you give up a first, a third, and then also a guy who's every bit as productive as Odell freaking Beckham Jr. with a quarter of the headaches, who's actually a good dude? You're going to bring Diva onto your team after you just de-divified your team? That's the dumbest thing in the world.
Well, I don't know if Beckham is quite the diva, like at the Antonio Brown level.
Enough.
He's too much diva for you.
By far.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, you said, you know, you started out with like the Le'Veon Bell and no Antonio Brown because of, you know, all of the drama and everything. But, you know, Beckham's like a little different. No, he's not. He's the exact same frigging guy. Pouts when he loses, pouts when he doesn't get paid as much as he thinks he should be, has antics on the sidelines. No, thank you. Absolutely not.
See, his antics aren't as offensive to me.
That's fine, but just like Baldwin for him? No, thank you.
Okay.
Along with a first? Like that's like if you were the GM of the New York Giants and you just called me with that trade offer, I would have laughed my ass off if I was John Schneider.
Now, what if you're John Schneider calling the Giants? Do you think they'd take that deal?
Oh yeah, in a heartbeat.
Really? Okay.
Yeah.
My thought on this was
Beckham's not a game changer.
I think he is, and I think he's younger. And you started to see injury issues with Doug Baldwin this year. That's why the idea of that combination was somewhat intriguing to me.
I think it's a terrible idea.
Okay.
That's one of your worst ideas ever.
I'm willing to accept that I have bad ideas once in a while, but I mean, usually
you're a very brilliant guy and I respect your opinion, but that was stupid.
Pairing Russell Wilson with Odell Beckham and having Tyler Lockett on the team. I like that combination.
Yeah, sure. And then you don't have a first and you don't have a third the next year and you don't have Doug Baldwin.
There's no way that you would have Beckham, Baldwin and Lockett all on the team at once.
No, I wouldn't want him anyways. Like if it was trying to think of somebody that I'd be more, more agreeable to that situation with, like,
what about Green? AJ Green.
If Julio Jones was the same age as Beckham, like I'd be like, I would consider that.
Cause Julio's kind of getting up there too, though.
That's what I'm saying. He's not the same age as Beckham. So, yeah. And not only that, but like, sure, Baldwin had injuries for the first time in his career this year.
Yeah.
Yeah. And now you're ready to boot him off the bus?
For the right guy.
I hope your wife listens to the podcast and knows just how loyal you are.
My loyalty is to whoever's on the team. There's going to be some things that happen in this offseason where guys go to other teams.
Yeah.
And I'm going to have to say, okay, because look, some of the loyalty is so strong that people are saying, oh, hey, maybe we should think about having, in terms of wide receivers that come back, what about this Jermaine Kearse guy and having him come back?
Yeah, that makes some sense.
Oh, sure. Yeah, for the right price.
Yeah, but you're going to tell me that Odell Beckham Jr. is going to be happy in a very predominantly run heavy offense.
Isn't that what he had to deal with?
And I'm about the ball. He didn't even have a
quarterback who could get him the ball. He would be ecstatic to have Russell Wilson as his quarterback.
Is it any different getting, 4 and 20 balls completed to you by Eli Manning? And you just had to run a few up more routes and waste your energy, or getting, 4 balls from Russell Wilson on, 10 routes. You're still only catching 4 balls.
But did you see a lot of antics from Odell this last year with what he had to deal with, them being a predominantly run game?
Once is a coincidence. When he gets to 3, let me know.
Okay.
3 years of not being a knucklehead.
He got paid. He's growing up. I think he'll be one of the good ones.
No, he would not be one I'd bet on that one.
Well, we'll check in a couple of years, see where we're at.
Okay.
Well, let's move on. Let's bring on James and Bear from the Rams podcast and get them their perspectives on the season, where the Rams are going forward, and talk about this bet that we lost, Adam.
Yeah, they'd probably make that trade for Beckham if they were in charge of the Seahawks.
I know they would.
Yeah, just to screw us. All right, bring them on. Let's get it over with.
And joining us from the Rams podcast, we got James and Bear back on to talk about the bet that we set up among the four of us to start the season. And we can talk a little bit about the Super Bowl and what's in store for the Rams coming up in 2019. James, Bear, how you guys doing?
Well, for me, I've been in a cave for the past 2 weeks, to be honest with you. I've, a little down after that Super Bowl loss, but I'm glad to be back talking about football and looking forward. But yeah, the past 2 weeks, it's been a little dark.
Yeah, I'm glad you led with the bet that we had. That kind of cheered me up as I was thinking of this intro. I was like, it could go real bad. You know, it could start with the Super Bowl. We could just lay it all out there. And it was nice of you to welcome us with reminding us that we won at least something, here out of the four of us talking today. And we'll get into that Super Bowl. You're right. It wasn't what we wanted to represent, but there are things to look back in the season and say, hey, at least we got that.
Well, yeah, we wanted to lead with the bet part because I just wanted to get the crap that I don't want to talk about out of the way so that we can talk about the really fun stuff like how Sean McVay got his lunch ate in the Super Bowl. So let's talk about the bet. Now Bear and I, we bet whether or not the Seahawks or the Rams would be the leader in the division by the end of the year. And, the Rams did end up, 3 games up on the Seahawks, but I got to tell you, Bear, I got to ask, you never expected it in a million years to be that close. I bet.
I did not, especially as the season started out and we got out to that. I mean, we were 9-10-0 to open the season, and looking at how the Hawks were at that point, I was ready to clinch that bet and have a jersey sent over, by week 10, week 11. I thought that thing was wrapped up. You guys fought hard till the end and made it competitive. And, you know, obviously got into that wild card position. And I got to come back at you guys really quick. And I know we'll talk Super Bowl and we'll have chances to take digs, but I was really actually pulling for you guys down in Dallas to come back up to Seattle or come back up to LA for that third battle between division rivals. And man, you guys let us down. What happened there too? I mean, we'll have a chance to talk about that, but I was hoping for that third because I really wanted you to give you a chance to kind of put it back for a double or nothing, to give you an opportunity to win that thing back. But we didn't get to see that third game. We'll just have to wait for next season, I guess.
Well, that was one question I had for you, Bear. When we started the season and Adam brought up the idea of betting straight up on who would win the division. See, I had it in my mind to tell Adam that you should try and get some games from these guys, because as soon as the schedule came out, you know, you and James are talking about the Rams going 13-3, 14-2. So I want to know if the idea of the amount of games would have come up. How many games did you have the Rams beating the Seahawks by, and how many of games would you have given Adam if that would have been part of the bet?
Great question. And I'd love to go back to the tape and actually re-listen, because I think there was even a couple moments where I loosely threw that out there and then took it back as far as like, that's how confident I was. But if I actually had to commit to games, I think my confident in the moment, fired up talking with you guys, I think I would have said 3. I think that's where I would have landed. But then, you know, having the James mentality in the back saying, dude, calm down, don't go too crazy. I think I'd back it down to about, at least I think I'd take one game back. And I think I was pretty confident with a 2-game win over the division going into it. I mean, we were so hyped up. It really didn't even turn out the way we exactly thought as far as, you know, looking at this defense that we went out and got. And we're like, man, no one's ever going to score points on us. And then it found out that our defense was one of the weaker parts throughout the season until the playoffs. But, you know, we kind of had this higher expectation of what was really coming in. So I think at that point, I definitely would have been open to giving a couple games, especially as a straight up bet. I really just didn't see the Seahawks taking over and you know, winning that division at that point. And obviously through the season, I didn't. But probably about 2 games is where I think you could have talked me into it.
Now, James and I had the bet of who would have more interceptions between Shaquille Griffin, you know, coming into his second season, and Marcus Peters, who was picked up off from the Chiefs in the offseason. And, you know, I was confident that even though Shaquille Griffin didn't have any interceptions his rookie season, that this was going to be a big year for him where he made a leap. And I expected Peters, even though he had a lot of interceptions, to kind of come back down to earth a little bit. Maybe they'd stay away from his side of the field. And I thought we had a pretty good bet going, James. And I think for both of us, it turned out to be one of the most boring bets that I've ever entered into.
Definitely one of the most boring, but I'm of course happy that I chose that because I am yet to win in any of our bets. So I'm happy. I was a little worried in the beginning of the season. I think we both started off with one interception early on. And then when
you started off with one early on and Shaq Griffin got both of his 2 interceptions game against the Lions. And so I was up on you for a good while, 2-1.
Right, you were, and I was shaking in my boots a bit because, and then when Tlaib got hurt, the performance from Marcus Peters kind of died back, so I was a little bit worried that he wasn't going to be able to get anything done, and, you know, he started missing tackles, and I didn't know if he was going to get a big interception. Every single game, I would text Bear, like, this is going to be his game interception for a touchdown, I promise you, it's going to happen. So I started off, like you said, shaking in my boots a bit, but I'm glad that he ended up with 3 overall and pulled through for us.
Yeah, next time, let's not bet on defensive stats for a bet. Because it is very lackluster, except for maybe sacks. I guess maybe that would be something that's actually exciting. But interceptions, I mean, who leads the league this year in interceptions? It can't be more than 10.
Yeah, I think it was one of the guys from Chicago had about 6 or 7. You're right. It was kind of a boring one to follow. But at the same time, it was kind of like watching golf or soccer in a sense. Like when something exciting did happen, it was like, oh my gosh, another interception. Or when Marcus Peters, I mean, we got to break him down all year in the disappointment. And I brought the bet up a lot through our conversations with James because, you know, James was one of the biggest, at least on our conversations, the biggest hater of Marcus Peters throughout the year. Like this guy, you know, he got our anti-game ball, which is our play action ball, which is we give to a player that, you know, we are disappointed in throughout the season or in a game. And he got that more than anybody else this season from James. And he kept going, man, I can't believe him. I don't want to resign him, this and that. And I'm like, that's your guy. And he ended up coming out and that, and, you know, he turned the page a little bit. but won it for James just by a, what it ended up being one, right? I think it was
a tipped pass in either week 16 or 17 where he got his third interception for the year.
Right. I will say though, I mean, if you go back to the beginning of the season and kind of look at where you were, the potential for our bet throughout the season kind of would allow us to maybe bite our nails a little bit more than Adam and Bear's bet, because in the beginning I was just like, Bear, you got this one, solid man. I know that the Rams are going to win the division, but you were making me worry when you guys were talking about in that initial show. How many games you're going to give him, because we called each other afterwards and Bear can come, you know, get a little excited when it comes to bets and make some silly decisions. So I'm glad that it ended up winning for both of us. But Bear, you know, I'll tell you one thing, Adam, you can probably, if you keep the conversation going, you can probably get him to bet quite a bit this next year.
All right. Well, hey, I'm still hanging my head a little bit from this last year. But with that said, like if Pete Carroll would have just given the ball to Chris Carson the first three games instead of not giving the ball to Chris Carson, like we might have been tied. Yeah. I mean, it would have been close. And then the games between Rams and Seahawks were so damn close.
Right.
Yeah. Pete Carroll himself, I think, like a lot of us, I mean, you guys were near the bottom of the barrel last year in rushing yards. And then this year ended up at the top of the barrel, right? And I think it just took a couple of games for Pete Carroll to go, wow, we actually have an offensive line that's going to move the football. And we've got a couple backs, Chris Carson being one of them, being able to give him the rock. And once he switched that up and you guys went to that ground and pound, you guys were a completely different team. I totally agree. And that's why I'm kind of curious about what is next for you guys. And we can have this conversation on both sides of the table. But I'm really curious about the running back situation. Free agency. One of the questions I really have for you is, are you interested in going and getting a big time back? And I know, you know, Le'Veon Bell's going to, you know, command a huge salary that you guys might not be able to afford. But would that be a guy you'd be interested in if you've seen what the run game could do to add kind of that elite player? Or are you good with that running back class that you guys already have?
Yeah, I'm not remotely interested in Le'Veon Bell. That guy, the locker room cancer, the head case, the guy who may or may not play, depending on whether or not he feels like he's getting paid enough that day. Like, no thanks. I'll take somebody who's productive like Chris Carson, who's a seventh round pick who I have to pay basically tiddlywinks to, and I can actually keep spending on, you know, defensive line and offensive line. That's what I want to see this offseason. I want him just to build in the trenches even more. Like, just put everything right there.
Well, and that's one of the things that Adam and I have talked about just in these last few shows after the season. You know, what are the position groups that you feel good about versus which position groups do you think that the Seahawks could actually improve upon? And we look around the team, and apart from quarterback with Russell Wilson, the one position group that we kind of agreed on that we're pretty okay at is running back. And like, address anywhere else. I mean, if you decide to bring back Mike Davis, you already have Chris Carson and you have your first round pick, Rashad Penny. So do they really? And then they have a couple other guys, you know, CJ Procise, who didn't really play this year. He's still under contract.
He's not on the team.
Well, you don't expect him to be on the team, but he's on the team right now.
He is not on the team.
I'm just saying it's a position that we weren't that concerned about.
So that's an interesting question on the flip side for you guys, James and Bear, about the running back situation. I mean, so this was Gurley's third year, correct? Or fourth year? Third year.
Fourth year, because he just signed a new deal going into this year.
Yep.
Right. So basically, you know, had the decent rookie season, but you kind of these last couple seasons, you see him break down towards the end of the year. Like, and you see somebody like Fat CJ Anderson come in and be more productive. Like, what's your concern there? I mean, are you guys looking at CJ Anderson and saying, we need to bring him back? Do we need to bring in more depth behind Gurley and take some carries out of his hands?
I'll start that. And I don't really think that I would say Gurley broke down. I think that he, you know, we were hearing that there were some issues with his knee, nothing too serious, but they were just not giving him the playing time he expected. And it ended up working out for us. CJ Anderson was amazing in the playoffs. And, you know, you kind of, that question's up in the air is, why didn't we utilize Todd Gurley enough in the Super Bowl? And, you know, that's a great question. But when we're looking at the offseason and moves we're going to make, I have zero concern about Todd Gurley or going on to next year. I think he's going to have an amazing year again. Not too sure what we're going to do with CJ Anderson, but man, did he perform well for us. And as far as being concerned about it, I just think, you know, Gurley was having a little bit of being sidelined because of his knee hurting. And I just think that we weren't able to really fit him back into the equation towards the end. And, you know, everybody in Rams Nation is still all confused about it. I'll, of course, let Bear provide more detail. But, you know, concern with Gurley, none for me.
Yeah, it's crazy. That's a tough one because there's, I mean, that is the almost the question of the offseason for the Rams, besides what are we going to do with like the 45 free agents that we have, and how are we going to try to spend money to rebuild this that way? Are we looking to kind of find other pieces and you know, create a new team to kind of go after another Super Bowl run? But with Todd Gurley, man, it is frustrating. There were points where we were, you know, boldly saying, you know, he's an MVP candidate. He deserves to be in that conversation. Up to about week 12, week 13, he was in that mix. And then all of a sudden, he gets a little banged up. He misses a couple games. We pick up CJ. And then in two of the biggest games of his career, he's won, not really utilized. So we can't blame him too much for that. But then two, when he does kind of got those opportunities, you know, we saw him in that New Orleans game tip the pass, which got intercepted. He dropped two other passes. He kind of went back to that style that we saw under Jeff Fisher, where he kind of just didn't have that confidence. He'd get the ball, he'd run to the line, he'd hit the first guy in the back, a lineman, and he would just not go anywhere. We saw him open up a little bit in the Super Bowl on some of those outside zone run concepts that he did so well throughout the season. But there's a lot of questions on, you know, there, now people are trying to say, oh, the relationship between those two, or it's getting, you know, will they trade Todd Gurley? And it's like, wow, there's a lot of noise behind it. And there will be all the way up till week one of the NFL season. How is he going to be utilized? And the first question starts with like what you said with CJ Anderson. Is he someone you want to bring back? I say yes. We had Malcolm Brown back there, and you need somebody to let the guy breathe a little bit or come in or create some sort of matchup problem for a defense, make them think a little bit. We begged for them to put both those guys in the backfield in the playoffs. They never seemed to really want to do that. But a lot of questions there. I like CJ. I think CJ is a great veteran guy to have on here. He's countable as far as in pass blocking. Even when you want to give him 10 carries, he can be productive that way. So we saw Malcolm Brown have a pretty decent season before he got injured. I'd like to have a complimentary back. I think CJ's looking for a home. I don't know how much after having a, you know, a couple really good games, what he's going to try to demand as far as looking at money. I think that's what it comes to, obviously, on every team at the end of the day. But I love the combo of those two together. I just want to see Todd at, you know, the highest point of what we know Todd Gurley with CJ Anderson, and not kind of this shell of himself. And, you know, is he injured? Is, you know, the game plan not going the right way? But, you know, you go back to that Super Bowl and you look at our first eight drives. We didn't have anything over five plays on any of those drives. It's tough to get your number one running back going, especially as, you know, he likes to utilize that play action and try to pass the ball a little bit. When you can't get more than five plays on a drive, it's hard to heat up a running back. But we definitely have to figure out what is the method that we use week 1 through 13 and do that a full season. Or if we're going to do it in those chunks, do it in the second half. Maybe the first five games we'll let Todd Gurley kind of suck and be questioned about, and then let him tear off all those great 100-yard games, three touchdown games. But it was really disappointing, obviously, at the end of it to see, man, we've got a running back controversy to end the season coming out of a Super Bowl. That's going to make for a fun offseason, right?
Yeah, that had to be unexpected for you guys. I'm curious, though, when you go back and you look at that, now everybody's talking about, is Todd Gurley hurt? And is that why the Rams didn't use him to, you know, kind of the way they expected to use him? Was it the way, you know, Belichick kind of coaches his team to take out the one part of the game that he thinks is going to beat you? And did McVay think that Todd Gurley was going to be that guy that Belichick was going to try and take away? So was there just some gamesmanship there? In your opinion, what was really happening there to why Todd Gurley didn't get his opportunities, especially in the Super Bowl?
Belichick thinking that they're going to need to stop Gurley was kind of an obvious, but at the same time, Gurley wasn't really that impact player in the postseason for us as much as CJ Anderson was. So I think Belichick understood that he definitely had to stop the run. But here's the issue: with the first drive of the game, like Bear mentioned, we tried running the ball twice, and then we did a bootleg and we did a shotgun for Jared Goff. I think we should have attempted to run the ball all three plays, in order to get those guys a little bit more comfort and kind of ship away. Goff running a bootleg on the third play of the Super Bowl just wasn't a smart decision. I was pretty irritated that we weren't trying to run the ball, and I would have been a lot happier if we just ran three run plays in a row and it didn't work out and we ended up punting, because then you can try to just relax a bit. You know, Goff is still pretty young. Tom Brady had been in the Super Bowl 9 times, and this was Goff's first appearance, and he was just, I just think we should have cooled the engines with doing our typical plays. I'm really surprised that Sean McVay didn't mix things up a lot more against New England, because we all know that they're able to break these offenses down, and we didn't mix things up enough. And to begin the game, I just don't think we tried to run the ball enough.
Yeah, it goes back to, you know, just like James said, starting out the game, we didn't get him going. You got to rev that engine from the beginning. And I think he had 3 touches in the first half alone. That's not enough for your stud running back. And you're talking about only getting 5 plays in your first 8 possessions. Like James said, I almost would almost rather have him be stubborn and go run to open the game and really just say, hey, we're going to pound it. And then we're going to use that play action behind it and really commit to the run and build everything off of that. I think he tried to get into that play action and getting Jared Goff going before we actually got a run game going. And it played right into Bill Belichick's hands. He started throwing different looks that they'd seen in the last 2 weeks that they prepared for. You heard Andrew Whitworth and McVay talk after the game about how they saw different looks that they weren't really expecting. And for me, if you're seeing that in a secondary, like, just go back to the ground. Just pound it. You got 2 guys. We just talked about you got 2 guys, especially C.J. Anderson, who's like a bowling ball. Like, let him just fall forward for 3 yards. I know he was getting met in the backfield a handful of times. But, yeah, I think the play calling, and it was just a disappointment in that game. You go back to Sean McVay, and he always takes blame for it. So it's tough because you can't be like, why won't you just, you know, accept accountability? He always does that. But at this point, we're so used to that we're like, I don't want to hear you say it's your fault. Like, just do something different. Like, make adjustments at halftime. It's a Super Bowl halftime. You got 45 minutes or whatever it feels like. You need a whole concert going on. Make some adjustments. Come out, run the ball. If they're doing something different you weren't expecting, do something different to throw at them. And that would be maybe putting both running backs in the backfield. Have a couple things that if it's not going right, go to this. And they just didn't seem to have that second page of production. And the you know, upsetting thing is we look over the defense. Our defense played really, really well against Tom Brady and the New England Patriots in the Super Bowl, but they don't get much credit because it came down to that fourth quarter and Tom Brady does what Tom Brady does and goes and makes a big throw and the one big drive that brings us down, and we couldn't really respond. So that was the frustrating thing, is seeing what this offense can do all year long and then coming to the biggest stage and then have to hear everyone in the national media go, 3 points? 3 points? So, yeah, frustrating to say the least, but it'll be interesting to see how they come out next season, if they come out on fire with that offense or if they come out, you know, with that Super Bowl hangover you always hear about.
Bear, that's hilarious to hear you talk about the offense, because all year we were hearing Sean McVay is changing the NFL, this high-flying, high-octane offense, and throw the ball all over the field and then, you know, with run it with Gurley behind that, and just everybody just oogling over the, you know, 45 points a game and all that stuff. And now you're sitting there going, yeah, man, I just wanted him to pound the ball like two backs and just have a dude fall forward for like 3 yards. And like, that sounded like Pete Carroll's Seahawks football. That's what that sounded like.
Oh, yeah, exactly. And you're right. I'm sitting here begging on Super Bowl Sunday to see 32 rush attempts. Like, that was my goal, was to see 32 rush attempts on Super Bowl Sunday. You're right. It blows my mind even thinking about it too. But man, that is the way that football team seemed to, it's like they peaked early and then they fought through a couple tough times near the end of the season, came into the playoffs limping and kind of changed their profile. And then that's kind of what you had to go get from them. But yeah, it's funny hearing you say that too, because you're right. We were talking about, Jared Goff at a time for MVP, which now everyone would roll their eyes 10 times over with that thought, thinking back to early in the season when he had some high touchdown numbers, low interception numbers, and some good yardage. But man, that passing attempt just really, I mean, the loss of Cooper Kupp was huge for us. I mean, moving forward, trying to fill that role.
I got to stop you with this Cooper Kupp thing.
All right. Oh, come on, bring
it. Every broadcast that I listen to, when the Rams start to struggle for 2 seconds, well, you know they lost Cooper Kupp, and that was basically their entire offense, and the whole thing fell apart. Like, it was like he was, it's like he was Jerry Rice and Calvin Johnson put together into one receiver, and he made the entire league go, and like, he goes out, and like, apparently nothing can be done on the Rams offense anymore.
Well, I think, unlike, you know, classifying him as this Jerry Rice, he allowed us to open things up, and he was a, you know, they had a lot of trust from Jared Goff. I think we were 60%+ on third down conversions when Cooper Kupp was in the mix versus below 30% when he wasn't. So Cooper Kupp added an element to this offense that we just couldn't replicate, which kind of helped bring everything down a bit. I mean, we couldn't open up the running game as much when we had couldn't rely on him. His replacement, Josh Reynolds, is an amazing receiver, but he can't run routes like Cooper Kupp. He's tall and lengthy, can snag that ball, but you know, he doesn't have the route running that Cooper Kupp did, and that route running opened up availability for the other receivers and opened things up in the running game for us too. So, you know, I think all those things were a huge factor on the decline there. Yeah.
I think what Adam's getting at, though, is that, yes, he's good, but should he have been the difference that you can point back to and say Cooper Kupp was the difference between the Rams scoring 3 points in the Super Bowl and scoring 16 points? You would, if you would have gone into that game knowing that the Patriots were only going to put up 13 points on the board, you wouldn't have said, oh, well, not having Cooper Kupp wouldn't be a factor in not winning this game. We'll be able to score 16 points easy on this
team.
Well,
I think by the time it got to the Super Bowl, we were kind of, you know, done playing the Cooper Kupp game because our offense has evolved at that point, right? We had CJ Anderson, who was a major threat going into the Super Bowl, who would have thought we would have been a dual back threat back there. And, you know, in the beginning of the season, that was by far not the case at all. So we had evolved a lot. Our defense was a completely different defense than we saw in the beginning of the season too. So yeah, you're right. I mean, you go in saying the Patriots are only going to score 13. It's almost a, you would think, a guarantee that the Rams are going to get more than that. But it was just offensively, man, it just was. And I don't think people really were pointing the finger at Cooper Kupp at that point. I think that was, you know, a lot of the conversation when he initially got hurt in the beginning. But when it got to the Super Bowl, we were a completely different offense.
Yeah, that's a great point for James as far as saying, you know, the offense was different at that point. But at the same time, as you were kind of, you know, building that, Brandon, and saying if he was there and they only scored 13 points, would you have felt more comfortable with that? I was kind of nodding my head going, yeah, though, because there were so many plays where, you know, we had 3rd and 2 or 3rd and 4 and Jared Goff got pressure and didn't have that release valve. James said the stats, 60% on 3rd down with Cooper Kupp down to like 32 without Cooper Kupp. I mean, he was the go-to 3rd down guy, and we just didn't have that extra release valve. It was Brandon Cooks, Robert Woods, and Todd Gurley the rest of the season, and then obviously we just talked about what Todd Gurley did. So it was 2 guys, you know, and we had a sprinkle of Gerald Everett and, you know, Higbee in there, but there was no consistency with Reynolds even. We just didn't have that guy that, you know, almost in a sense Jared Goff could close his eyes and just throw it in a direction, and that's where Cooper Kupp was going to be. He was that impactful on this offense, and if you just watched him throughout the beginning of the year, if he stayed healthy, we possibly could have had 3 wide receivers over 1,000 yards. He was on that pace for that, and obviously the other two with Woods and Brandon Cooks went over that 1,000-yard mark, but it was tough for people to stop 3 weapons in the passing game, and when it came down to going, all right, we got to stop 2 or at least control 2, and then these other guys are, you know, let them get their 4 catches for 60 yards if they're lucky, right? And Jared Goff lost that comfortability, and then our whole offense changed. So I do, in a weird way, think if we had Cooper Kupp in this game, we may have seen a different outcome just on Jared Goff having another target to really relieve to. I mean, yeah, it's tough to say. It's a lot of guessing game, and from an outsider's perspective, I could understand where you're going, yeah, right. But here at Rams Nation, we believe that.
Well, I believe that you believe that Cooper Kupp was maybe the biggest what if from the season. You know, what right. if he would have stayed healthy through the whole season? Now, the one thing I want to ask both of you is, what's the biggest what if from within that game? You know, if the Rams make a play at one particular moment in the game, how does it change the rest of that game? Is there any play that jumps out to either of you as, you know, if the Rams would have converted in this particular situation, if a guy would have held onto the ball, what play was that for you?
Well, Brandon, I can answer that real quick for you. The what if is the what if is what if Bill Belichick hadn't started texting Sean McVay through the entire season and gotten into his head like in week two? Like, that's the biggest what if of that game. Belichick knew who he thought he was going to be facing. He started playing head games with McVay back in the middle of the regular season.
Yeah, right. You watch some of the sounds of the game, and right before the game, McVay goes up to Belichick, and before Belichick even says hi, he's like, "I respect you, man. I love everything about you." And it's like, you're right. He played him early as far as getting the respect, but as far as the actual game goes, I know there's a couple, so I'll take a couple. I'll leave a couple for James, because obviously we know a couple big ones as well. But I really look at, and this is, and I hate for this as my lead, because obviously, we went through the whole New Orleans game and had to deal with the pass interference and everyone complaining about the refs and whatnot. And I'm not saying this isn't a hold or not, but there was a play in the fourth quarter with about 10 minutes to go where we had just stopped them. It's 3-3. We're getting the ball. We're finally got consecutive plays in a row where we're moving the football. And hey, we actually gave it to our stud Todd Gurley, who broke off about a 14-yard gain where he cut to the left. It was called back on a holding on John Sullivan. You go back and you look at it, like he's got him in position in front of him, and the guy leaps to the right. There may be a little bit of hold, but it brought us back, and it ended up giving us a second and 20 instead of a first down inside the Patriots field position. From there, we absolutely have horrible play calling. I think it ends on a third and 20 draw that goes for like 1 yard, and we end up punting the ball. It was a terrible punt from Johnny Hecker that gave him position at the 30-yard line. And what do you know? Tom Brady takes that, comes all the way down the field, and scores a touchdown. So that whole little from the hold to the bad punt leads right into them getting points. They take the lead 10-3. And that was, for me, that was the ball game. But there are a couple other plays. I'll let James.
You know what, Bear? I have to interrupt you. I think you were right to hesitate before coming to that play, because from a Rams fan complaining about a call in the Super Bowl, when it was a call that got you to the Super Bowl, you probably should have just left that one out.
Yeah, you can't. But at the same time, whether or not I agree with the call, which I'm not saying I don't agree or disagree with the call, but that play, if it was a blatant hold, it still would have killed us. That play still, I would still look at that play. If he grabbed in the face mask and took his head off, I would still look at that play and go, that was the deciding play in my eyes, where we're driving. We get a big run from Todd Gurley, who's been nowhere all game, starting to get some confidence, and all of a sudden we're punting, bad punt, they come down and score a touchdown. So yeah, I don't want to complain about the call at all, because I had to deal with that for 2 weeks, and I was so done with the petitions and, you know, all this stuff. And so yeah, I don't want to complain about the call at all, but that play to me is really where everything turned.
Oh, well, they got you, Bear, on the no call. Yeah. And, you know, I think Brandon Cooks is going to be kicking himself for a couple missed potential touchdown passes. And I think for me specifically, the play in earlier on in the game, the one to not tie the game when it was still the third quarter, about 3:40 left or so, we were down 3-0, and Brandon Cooks he could have pulled that in, and that one for me is the one that kind of hurt the most.
Yeah, I'll add one more Brandon Cooks play to that, and that is the pass right before the interception that basically sealed the game. Is a beautiful pass from Jared Goff, and he didn't have many on this day. Maybe, you know, three or four, you know, great passes from Jared Goff. That was one of them, over the shoulder. Again, I'm not asking for any type of interference because it's a Super Bowl, but he had about a hand and a half on it. And as a good receiver, I expect you to make that catch. He couldn't get enough to get his second hand up to make the catch. He drops it. That would have put him down maybe at the one, maybe inside the end zone for a touchdown to tie that game at that point. Instead, it's broken up. He can't make the catch. That's the second, I don't want to say Brandon Cook fail, but drop pass from him in the end zone. And the next play, Jared Goff, I don't know why, but goes back to the exact same play as far as who he's throwing to. He's under pressure. He's throwing off his back foot. We talked about it as a throw that you just can't make in the Super Bowl at that point. There's no time when you're down 7 with 4 minutes to go, or whatever it is, that you're going to throw up a 50-50 ball. If that, like, that is not a let's toss it up type of throw. You got to let that one, you either eat the sack or you throw it out of bounds or you throw it at someone's feet. That was a really ill-advised pass, but that came again right after a play that you could look at as a turning play. So that's what happened. And you look at this game, four or five plays that really, you know, can decide a Super Bowl, and probably four out of five of them didn't go the Rams' way, and they were combined with mistakes. So, you know, you miss, you know, the holding, and then all of a sudden they come down and score, and then you have the miss touchdown pass, and then, you know, the next pass is an interception. So they turned fast in the Super Bowl, and it was disappointing. But those are probably a few that, you know, highlight the Rams' disappointment. And then there were three quarters of complete boringness that, you know, obviously you could highlight as well.
What about the strategy of McVay to not communicate with Goff once they lined up? Because all year they're operating one way, you know, get up to the line quickly, communicate with Goff before that 15 seconds of communication turns off. They seem to take a little bit different strategy with Belichick, you know, trying to take away some of the adjustments maybe on the defensive side. And they were much slower to get up to the line with the offense. And just the idea of doing it one way all season and then changing it in the Super Bowl in one of the biggest games, you know, why make that change?
Yeah, I just think that goes back into the McVay, what the heck are you doing? You know, scratching your head and you're behind this guy and you love the, you know, like Adam was saying earlier, oh, this is the guy that's changing the game and he's doing all these things. Then all of a sudden you get to the Super Bowl and you're like, oh, we're going to stay in the huddle longer. Oh, we're not going to get up there because of you, we're going to change this. And I just don't like that reactionary type of style that he kind of took, instead of just going, hey, this is what we are, this is what we do, you're going to have to try to figure out how to beat it. We kind of looked at them again, as Adam said, you know, week two when Belichick called him, maybe he's got in his head a little bit and he thought, I'm going to try to outsmart him and do this a little different and kind of throw him off. And Belichick was going, all right, whatever, like, we're still going to throw some zone defense at you and confuse you, and we're not changing what we're doing. So it was a game that I felt that he kind of tried to play with nobody, in a sense, because I think Bill Belichick is kind of above that. So it was a little shocking that we didn't do a lot of that hurry up. And the one thing is, to get into that hurry up, you got to move the football. You got to pick up first downs. That's a lot of times you see them get into that is after they pick up a first down, Jared Goff is running behind the line saying, get up, let's go. And, you know, I've said it five times, I'll say it one more time, the first eight possessions, five plays, they were just per possession on average. There was no chance to ever really get in that rhythm. And then I think they just got comfortable in, okay, this is what we're going to do in this game. And again, the adjustments were shocking from McVay that we didn't see more of them. So yeah, disappointment. Yeah. And I think that McVay's going to have to, you know, again, live on this one for a while, just like everybody, but a lot sits on his shoulders.
Yeah, and I'll just add to that. I just saw an interview recently with a linebacker from the Patriots basically saying that he was shocked that the Rams didn't have any creativity or didn't really mix things up too much in the Super Bowl. We saw that jet sweep. They shut it down immediately, and we didn't see anything new out of the Rams. We know that these guys had 2 weeks, even though they had to deal with all the media, to come up with some stuff, and everybody's talking about how Sean McVay is this offensive genius, and if you know him, that you can get yourself a job in the NFL. But then when it goes to the Super Bowl, he only scores 3 points and has no offensive production. And it was pretty sad that they just, against the Patriots, who's a smart team and smart coaching, this wasn't their first rodeo. But the Rams, for some reason, just didn't mix things up or get creative nearly at all in the Super Bowl. And that's probably part of the reason we didn't do crap.
Well, it is interesting to hear you guys talk about the inability of coaches to make adjustments, because you talked about earlier wanting to talk a little bit about the Cowboys and Seahawks and the fact that the Seahawks had that opportunity to beat the Cowboys and come to LA, have that third matchup between these two teams. And for us, too, it was that game against the Cowboys and Seattle that we were frustrated with the coaches and the inability to make adjustments. You know, they were like, you were frustrated that they didn't pound the ball early on in that game against the Patriots. That's all the Seahawks did against the Cowboys. And Dallas knew that it was coming, and they were able to stop it for the entire first two quarters. Even in the third quarter, the Seahawks come back out and they take that same strategy of continue to pound the ball. All we wanted them to do was make an adjustment, try and throw the ball down the field a little more, because they were not giving Seattle an inch in the run game. And so it's kind of interesting that both of us are frustrated to end the season with coaching adjustments, yet it's just a little bit in different directions.
Right.
Yeah, it's crazy that it's so difficult for experienced coaches like Pete Carroll, or even a coach like Sean McVay, who's, you know, young and up and coming, being coaches that struggle with adjustments in game. That is something that is really bizarre to me. that would seem like the easiest thing to do. Oh, so we tried this and they're doing that. Okay, we'll do this instead. Like, I'm no rocket surgeon, but that feels like that should be the easier thing to do. It does seem like, you know, watching McVay over the course of this season, he's an amazing coach when he's got time to prep and he gets his game plan done ahead of time. But when it comes to actually having to make some big adjustments in game, like the Bears game kind of sticks out to me that way, might not be his strong suit yet. Or maybe they're just stubborn.
Maybe he just really wanted to watch the halftime show and decided to sneak out and watch some Adam Levine and Travis Scott instead of making adjustments during halftime. I don't know.
Nobody wanted to watch that halftime show.
McVay strikes me as a Maroon 5 fan, so you might be onto something.
I wouldn't be surprised if McVay is a Maroon 5 guy. So, yeah, maybe that was it. He snuck out for a little peek and was like, oh, crap, this is my time. And that was the thing we saw all season long. Wade Phillips was always what we talked about as kind of that halftime adjustment king in our year, because we always came out really soft on the defensive end in the first half. And then we found a way to hold a team to 3 or 7 points in the second half and really shut it down. But yeah, again, maybe that's something in McVay's early career. And I think that's something, you know, they look at and the people say, oh, Jared Goff isn't ready for this game. Sean McVay isn't ready. This is Sean McVay's second year as a head coach. He's got some learning to do, right? He has some growth and development. Same with Jared Goff, the fastest player to be drafted number one in the NFL draft and make it to the Super Bowl in his third year. And his first year, he didn't even play, really. I think his first start was up in Seattle with a special teams coach. I mean, so he's still developing in his own right. I don't think he was ready for that game as far as the experience goes and things like that. But I don't think he won't be ready for that game. I mean, we saw some really big throws from him in that New Orleans Saints game in that fourth quarter and overtime that kind of showed that he can handle a big-time situation. Even going back throughout the season, one of the bigger games you can look at is that game on Monday Night Football versus the Kansas City Chiefs. That was back and forth, and he made throw after throw in that game. So I know he can play in a big game, but these guys are still getting there for the first time. I know that's not really the best excuse, but at the same time, I think that they will develop, and I'm still really excited about this team kind of moving forward.
Yep, they were too young, and you guys got your comeuppance, and I'm really happy about it. But let's talk about the next season, the Rams going forward here. You know, everybody, we saw this team come together last offseason. The GM kind of took an approach of go for broke and loaded up on a lot of talent. And you got a lot of guys that are coming available here in free agency. I mean, as I look at the list, like, I don't know what you guys are going to do without Sean Mannion, QB.
Oh, God. Yeah. You know what's funny about Sean Mannion, too, is I loved is there was so much talk about Sean Mannion in the preseason because, one, we didn't see our starters all preseason. So all we got to look at was Sean Mannion. But everyone was so concerned about Sean Mannion and last season going, we got to get rid of this guy. And you're right. He's on the list in that free agent. On that free agent list. And you know what? I think it's time to let Sean Mannion go, but I love that intro. But there is a lot of guys that we have to make decisions on. And you know, there's guys like Ndamukong Suh, who was kind of a one-year rental, seeing what we're going to do with him. He didn't play really well until, you know, the final three games of the year. LaMarcus Joyner was our franchise tag. He didn't really, I guess, play himself into a massive contract. There's going to be some team out there that will pay him. I still think he's a great safety in that regard, but is he worth the big bucks that he may feel coming off of a franchise tag? You know, Roger Saffold, one of the key pieces, one of the longest tenured Rams on the O-line, you know, and then there's like, you know, even looking at some of the other guys as far as that came up this year, Corey Littleton played out of his mind, played really well. He's still really young, really cheap, but he's a free agent, so he's going to deserve some money. I'm wondering if there's going to be a team that wants to invest and try to give some more money or what the Rams value that at. And then the decisions of just a couple of the new guys that we got, Aqib Talib, Marcus Peters, both those guys we can get out of their contract for this coming year and be able to kind of slide through and dump some money and you know, go a different direction. Mark Barron's another one that's going to be paid, you know, I think $8 million next year, but dead money's only worth like $1 million. We didn't get great production with him until the end of the year. Shocker, all these guys that are on the free agent kind of hold it out for the end of the season. But there is a lot of decisions, you're right. And I think kind of to just answer a couple of that, I'd be fine with seeing Sue leave. I would love to see Barron maybe moved and get a different position at linebacker there. I would love to see us keep our cornerbacks as much as we hated on Marcus Peters. I think with him, with Tlaib healthy, I think is a great combination. But James, your thoughts on some of our free agents and what we're going
to
do?
So I want to kind of branch out on what Bear was saying specifically when it comes to Peters, because we have a big time decision in this offseason on what we're going to do. Probably cost us $9 million to pick up that fifth year option, but it'll be kind of telling whether or not we re-sign him, because a lot of people thought in the beginning of the season that it was kind of a steal coming from Kansas City on as far as what we gave to them. But in the middle of the season, specifically me, I was throwing a lot of shade towards Marcus Peters and questioning a lot of his playability when it came to some of the fundamentals like tackling and how he was with the zone versus him being used to the man and his coverage there. So, you know, I'm interested to see what they're going to do with Peters and if they're going to spend that $9 million or whether they might look to move on. I think Bear's right that he works well when Tlaib is in the mix too. So it's going to be pretty interesting to see what we do. And then another thing that Bear didn't mention is Andrew Whitworth is going to have to make a decision on whether or not he's going to retire. He's going to have to make that decision by March 13th. And that's going to be a big piece too, because, you know, our linemen, we got John Sullivan there, who I've heard a couple complaints about through social media, what we're going to do with our linemen. I would say Andrew Whitworth is one of the top linemen in the NFL, in my opinion. So I hope that he comes back, but if he doesn't, that opens up a major hole in that offensive line. So this offseason is going to be really, really interesting for us.
So there's a couple offensive linemen that are long in the tooth. And so you mentioned Whitworth, who I do agree, I think, is a hell of a player. And he seems to be a hell of a dude on top of that. Mm-hmm. And you talked about the possibility of him retiring. You guys also talked about keeping Peters and Tlaib. I guess if it were me personally, I would see what goes on with Peters, what you can get him for. But I wouldn't overpay 1 cent for him. But Tlaib, yeah, that's the guy I bring back. He seems like the key cog in that defense somehow, other than Aaron Donald, of course, but of the new guys that came in. But also the other big key cog would be Wade Phillips. He's not exactly a spring chicken. Is he a guy that's going to be sticking around?
You know, they just actually signed his son, Wes Phillips, to come in and coach the tight ends. And it's weird because Wade Phillips, as old as he is, and maybe it's a generational thing, you think, oh, he's not going to be awesome on Twitter. But you're wrong. Wade Phillips is awesome on Twitter. If you're not following him, go follow him. And he puts out tweets, you know, randomly. And he put kind of a cryptic tweet out that kind of said Sean McVay and this youth of the coaching staff is going to be able to kind of move this team forward. And there was this, you know, people are like, is he going to come back? Is he not? And then he was interviewed later and he basically said his first year with the team, they went and knocked on the door. They didn't get anywhere. And the next year they went pounding on the door, a.k.a. this year into the Super Bowl. And then the following year, a.k.a. the year coming up, they're going to kick that son of a bitch down and go charging in and win the Super Bowl. So he made a bold statement that I kind of feel that he's coming back. But you're right as far as he's not a spring chicken. How many years do you get out of Wade Phillips? I think it's 1 to 2. It'd probably be, I mean, I would love 2 just because I love his personality with Sean McVay and kind of that youth and the wisdom and the knowledge and the age with Phillips as well. Adding his son, I think, is going to help kind of create him a little bit better environment to be around and that family thing, blah, 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 all that stuff. So I expect him around for at least 1 to 2 more years. I think he's still got it. I never really liked him as a head coach. I love him as a D coordinator, and we would be blessed, I think, to have him back because this defense, although struggled throughout time, was able to kind of find that core, find that wave, whether it was in the second half or not, or even into the playoffs. It takes time to gel these guys. That was the big question. All these new guys, how are you going to gel them? And I think he finally started to figure out the pieces, especially near the end. And we got a lot of youth. We finally have some draft picks. So I'd love to see Wade back for another year.
Well, when you're talking about and listing off the potential free agents, the three biggest ones that you mentioned were Sue, Saffold, and Joyner. Assuming that you can only keep one of those three guys, which one do you pick?
Roger Saffold, no doubt about it. Joyner, I think we can replace with a safety. I think there's plenty of opportunity, whether through the draft or even, I know a guy up in Seattle that isn't too fond of the Seahawks and would love to play them twice a year that I think is coming off an injury that may be a little bit cheaper than you normally would be that I would love
to. You're not getting Earl Thomas, Bear. You're not getting Earl.
I was going to say, the big reason you're not getting Earl Thomas is your team's name isn't the Dallas Cowboys.
Yeah, well, that's the funny thing. I think, you know, obviously, I think we've got a 1 in 4 chance of getting Earl Thomas because that is – three other teams in the NFC West that I think he's dying to play for, and then the Cowboys. So I'll take a 1-4 chance of getting Earl Thomas, especially when our team just went to the Super Bowl and has a couple other defensive players like Aaron Donald that you can say, hey, look at these guys, and Tlaib and Peters that we just said, come be a part of whatever nickname you want to name us next, you know, because they tried Los Angeles and that didn't work out really well this year. But I would love to see that. So I don't think it's LaMarcus Joyner. And Sue, I just honestly, unless he comes on a really discounted price because he enjoys the Super Bowl and wants to play in meaningful playoff games, I don't want to pay him $14 million again. I don't want to pay him $10 million a year. I don't want to pay, you know, I think my mark for him is going to be, you know, $7 to $8 million on another shorter, you know, maybe a 2-year deal. I don't know if that's going to be enough for him. So I let him walk for sure. And another name to throw in there is Dante Fowler. I mean, he's a young guy, former first round pick, fit in the system well. He was some of our only edge pressure. That's going to be a big concern for us moving forward. How do we get pressure other than Aaron Donald from the D line position? You know, so that's going to be interesting too. But I think right out the gate, it's Saffold, hands down.
Well, it's going to be an interesting offseason for you guys. There's definitely going to be a significant amount of change. I think that's one thing that we can all agree on. And I think it's going to make you guys worse. And we'll be beating you in the playoffs this year. So.
Yes, we're very hopeful for that. But you know what? You guys have the winning bet for 2018 to fall back on. So what are your plans for us now that you have each won over the both of us this past season?
Yeah, we got to know whose jersey you want and in what color. And then I know Bear's got a script to write for me that I have to read and put out. So that's going to be really fun.
Yeah, you got to remind me of this script because I was asking James the other day. I was like, I remember my ask was the loser was going to have to wear it regardless of any team making the Super Bowl on Super Bowl Sunday. That was thrown out immediately. I understand why. And this year, if that was actually agreed upon, can you imagine how rough that would have been having to wear a Rams jersey while they're playing in the Super Bowl? And so what was the script for? Because I remember something else part of the bet.
Yeah, basically, it can just be anything that you want me to say. Like, I have to read what you write down.
Oh, boy.
You know, like 30, 45 seconds, something like that.
All right.
And I'll do that wearing the jersey. And so,
all right.
I mean, well, I'm a man of my word. I lost the bet.
I like it. I like it. And you're my favorite person to bet with. I think I'm undefeated so far. So all bets are welcome again. We can do this again next year. We'll kind of.
Oh, what's happening, Mr. Short Sample Size? Okay.
It ended up being a pretty good year for us, and we'll take it for sure. I'm going to have to go to the drawing board and write a couple drafts. I never have good, I'm not good with the punctuation and everything. So I'll run it by my editor, James, to make sure that everything looks well. And we'll make sure we get something over to you here so you can read it. It's going to be fun, that's for sure. And as far as jersey goes, I may have to give it a think, but I'm already kind of leaning towards one guy I know that I really love and was discussed about in this show, and we didn't get to see him the full year, but that's Cooper Kupp, a former Washington product coming down here to California and making it big time. So that's probably where I'm leaning right away, but I'll have to go on to the Rams NFL shop and take a look and see what's available. They got a lot of these ugly Rams colors still out there until we rebrand it in 2020, which is kind of annoying, but it will probably be a blue jersey or a color rush jersey in that yellow. Everything else that is Rams doesn't really come out that well. But James, what are your thoughts?
So I agree with Bear. Got to do the retro blue and gold. Those are my favorite colors by far. I'm ready to move on to the new colors in 2020. So as far as jersey, it's kind of funny. When I was doing all my constructive criticism, I'd call it, with Marcus Peters over the season, I asked Bear, you know, at one point I even said, can I cross out the Peters jersey and make it somebody else? Because I was so frustrated with him. So, due to him winning me the bet, I think, I don't know if I had to default to a Peters jersey, but if I had to decide, I think Bear took my Kupp jersey. I don't know if those would be harder to get.
Yeah, we probably couldn't order two. That would probably be out of the question.
They're sold out. So, only one left.
I think I'm going to have to go with my boy Goff, though. I think I'm going to have to do a number 16. He was my dude all season, except for the Super Bowl. So that's my guy. And Brandon, I made a pretty good video for you last year, and I don't think we really solidified what we'd have to do, but I think we kind of agreed on some football drills or something along those lines.
Yeah, I think it was something from the Pro Bowl Skills Challenge was what we were going to shoot for.
Okay. So I think, yeah, we gotta tighten up exactly what we need, but I can't wait to see what you guys are able to put together and to rock my jersey all next season.
All right. So we're leaning Cooper Kupp and James has Jared Goff, but you know, if Bear wants to go with somebody else and you want to go back to Kupp or if you just want to go with Cooper Kupp, you know, both of you guys can like the same player. It's okay. We just need to know what we need to buy.
I refuse to buy a Cooper Kupp jersey unless one of you guys go through a whole show on, you know, either Locked On or the Rams podcast and can do the whole show. And when you talk about Mr. Kupp, not say Cooper Kupp. Like, because it seems like it's mandatory, league mandated that you have to say his full name every time. Nobody just says, hey, look, Kupp made a reception or good job by Cooper. It's always, oh, Cooper Kupp.
Well, it's funny because that is so true. 100% true. And for a while, we had Farrell Cooper on the team. So when you said Cooper, you threw people off because obviously we knew probably who you were talking about. So I think that was the trend of how it started. And then maybe Kupp was just too short, didn't have the Cooper Kupp together, just had, you know, especially once we had Marcus Peters on Monday Night Football to open it up and he was yelling, Cooper Kupp! Like, everyone just loved that clip that came out from that game. And it's just fun to say. I mean, you know, you love it.
So that's the deal. That's the deal, you guys. If you both want Kupp jerseys, you have to make it through one episode of the Rams podcast where you don't use both names together. He either has to be Cooper or Kupp, and that's
easy,
it.
Peasy.
Otherwise, you're going to have to pick two different jerseys.
Well, me and James hang out too much to have matching jerseys, so we'll have to do a rock, paper, scissors or something. We've gone throughout with having Rams podcast jerseys and shirts, and we look like little twinsies.
Yeah, so, we match enough probably at training camp. It's pretty embarrassing.
Yeah, we'll have to find something different.
All right, but you're definitely going retro blue and gold for both of them.
For sure.
All right, guys. Well, want to thank you for coming on the show and breaking down the Super Bowl, talking a little bit about our bet. And, you know, if people want to check out the show through the offseason, maybe they know a Rams fan who wants to listen. Where do they go to check you out?
Yeah, you can find us. We've got multiple things going right now. We've got Rams Podcast. So on Twitter and Instagram, it's at Rams Podcast. At Jay Kroger 3 for my man James. I'm LA _ Rambling Bear on Twitter. And we also have Locked On Rams. And we're on iTunes, Spotify, everywhere that you listen to a podcast. We're there. So, yeah, come check us out. Come try to troll us. We don't care. We're here to talk football and have fun. We're excited to talk to you guys again. So as we get a little bit further, maybe after the draft, we'll loop back with you guys and feel out how you feel about the draft and where the picks went. And we can kind of see what happened in free agency and talk about getting ready to, you know, sweeping you guys again in the NFC West.
Well, Bear, be sure that for your next trip to Disneyland, be sure to tell us when it is so we can continue to have Seahawks fans harass you while you're at the park.
Yeah, California people, it's in California. Enough Seahawk gear down here. It was pretty upsetting at Disneyland getting trolled by Seahawks fans in my NFC Championship shirt. But hey, man, I'll take it anytime. I always love the rivalry between the two teams, and you know, especially being closer here in California, it makes a lot more fun. So anytime you guys want to chat, hit us up. We'd be more than happy to do it.
Well, appreciate you coming on.
Cool. Yeah, thanks for having us.
You bet. Go Hawks.
Yeah, go Hawks. A big thanks to James and Bear. Those guys are always fun to talk to, even though they've made a terrible life choice in picking which team they want to root for.
They did it to themselves, so I really have no sympathy, but I do like the guys. Like, they're always just a treat to talk to, for sure. And I'm trying to say nice things, so maybe Bear doesn't make life totally miserable for me.
That's true. He has you under his thumb now with this script that he's going to be writing for you.
A little bit.
Yeah, that's not super exciting. Mm-mm. I'm not looking forward to having to open up the wallet either to buy jerseys for both these guys.
Yeah.
Maybe that's what we use all that field goals money for, that that they paid us to move over to their platform.
Yeah, that would probably pay for like a stitch in one of the jerseys.
I think I tallied it up from this last show, Adam.
Yeah.
We're going to be able to split $250.
That's amazing.
Oh, wait, no. Oh. That's each our share, and that's $2.50.
Oh, all right. Money, 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 money. Yeah. I'm getting rich.
Yeah.
What are you doing with your $2.50, Brandon? Tell me you're buying a Golden Girls calendar.
I should. I should buy Golden Girls calendar or there's so many different ways I could go with it. I could rent another Sandra Bullock movie after watching The Blind Side.
I'm gonna put a down payment on a sandwich.
You can do that?
I hope so.
You can down payment a sandwich.
I'm gonna go to Subway and see if I can't get like a meatball sub on layaway. I'd be like, no, hold on to it for just like two more weeks.
And, just put that sandwich in the back. Right. And preferably in the fridge.
Yes. Or just outside at this time of year. That'll be fine.
Right. And I'll come back for it. Right. When I get the rest of that field goal money.
Exactly. It'll be in another 4 weeks.
Well, I think what we're going to do moving forward, because it's fun to join a platform of, you know, something that we followed for so long, you know, getting a lot of Seahawks news through field goals and, you know, talking to Kenneth over the years before that, Danny Kelly. Mm-hmm. And it'll be fun to do the show over there. I know for some of our listeners, it's a little bit of a shift because, you know, you got to find another platform to subscribe to, especially if you listen on our app. You know, those shows aren't going to go through our Seahawkers podcast app. But you know what? We're still going to keep around the Seahawkers podcast feed. I'm still going to be putting out shows every other week through the off season, you know, on the off weeks that we're not doing a show for field goals, and having guys on like Rob Staton, you know, interviews with other podcasters throughout the off season, just to keep it going. And because I like doing this week to week, Adam, I know you need a break every other week. So I think that'll work out well for the both of us.
Yeah. It's going to be better. The less I have to talk about, you know, Tyler Lockett's tweets, or you know, anything like that.
He's got a strong Twitter game, though. You have to give him that.
Neat. Congrats. I got a new tablet, and the only place I could check Twitter was on my old tablet, because it was the only place I downloaded it. I have no idea what the password is to the Twitter account. Mm-hmm. It would auto log in, right?
Yeah.
And I never downloaded Twitter on the new tablet. I did that at right after Thanksgiving. You know what? I haven't missed one bit.
You missed Twitter?
No.
I could see that.
Yeah. Because say it with me, people. If it's on Twitter, it doesn't matter.
Offending all of the people in our Twitter audience that frequent Twitter. It's a good place for information.
No, it's just, that's it. Next time you start getting mad about things that are on the Twitter, just repeat that to yourself. It'll be better for you. It doesn't matter.
You shouldn't let it impact your life.
No, it's on Twitter.
It's like reading the YouTube comments.
Yeah, a little bit.
Although our YouTube commenters are awesome.
Yeah, surprisingly. Like, I was ready to get lambasted, you know, but everybody, for the most part, you know, hasn't been real mean.
Although it starts to get mean when we don't post the field goal shows to YouTube, because field goals doesn't seem to be into the posting on the YouTubes.
No, they're not a fan, apparently, for some unknown reason that couldn't be explained, but that's okay.
So YouTube people, follow us over. Find a platform where you can follow us on field goals.
Yeah. What is the way they can follow us on field goals, Brandon? How would you go about doing that?
I would check the show notes. And because we are in iTunes, we're in Spotify. The field goals feed is in iTunes. It's in Spotify. It's in Stitcher and all the podcast apps. If you have an Android device, there's subscribe on Android. There's a link for that. So I'll put it into the show notes. I'll put it up onto our Seahawkers podcast website for this episode. And that way people listening to this can go and find the new feed and listen to that the way they want to.
Be like what we've been doing over the years. That's we're doing the same dang thing on field goals, just with the name field goals instead.
Right.
So yeah, that's where the show will be, as always, the same as it ever has been.
Yeah. We're not changing the show, really.
No. I mean, we've over the years, we've tweaked it like here and there, just little things. But like, yeah, no, it is what it is.
It's you and me talking Seahawks.
Right. And the little flockers off. And a do better and a better life.
That's it. That's the formula.
Yeah, we got it.
Radu Marcharant, he posts on Facebook, says super cool in reaction to our announcement this last week. How are you guys planning the frequency of this versus the original, or is it replacing the original? And I think we covered that, you know, doing that every other week on each platform through the off season. Once the season starts, you know, we'll figure it out from there.
Right. Yeah. We're just kind of, you know, giving it a little test spin here.
Yeah. We're weighing it.
See how it works. Yeah.
On YouTube, Beanie says, does this mean less Seahawks podcasts? No, it's going to be week to week, but
every other two spots.
Just in two spots. I know.
Right.
And Jacob asks, will all the shows still be on the app? As far as the Seahawkers podcast shows, they will still be there. And the Field Goals podcast, until they have an app, they'll be in the feeds that we mentioned. Best places to try and find it through there. And lastly, Sam Dath, he says, I am excited for the Field Goals podcast and Seahawkers podcast teaming up throughout the offseason. Go Hawks. Thanks, Sam.
Hey, thanks, man. Yeah, I'm excited for it, too. It's going to be fun to be exposed to a whole new group of people and kind of see where things go. See if there's a chance for some extra growth there and, you know, grow the community of all these little flockers, man.
And we've seen in the comments through Field Goals that a couple of people found us who had never heard of us before. So after doing this for 6 years, you'd think, oh, Seahawks fans who listen to podcasts,
right?
They should know that we're out there. Well, yeah. Turns out
not so much.
But that just goes, you know, it lets you know if you have a friend who's a Seahawks fan and you think, oh, well, they should know. Right. They may not know. And the best way to spread the word about Adam and I doing shows is through word of mouth and letting them know.
Absolutely.
All right. Well, some people who do know about the show and participated in our Pick'em League this last year, Jesper Sacco, we're going to be bringing him on and talking about his big win. And before we do that, let's talk about the people who were in the top four for the Pick'em League, starting with number four, Casey Hawk, who wins the Cam Chancellor signed football. So congrats to Jeff and KC for the win.
That's a damn good prize for fourth place.
I know you were wanting that. You had your eyes on that at the beginning of the season.
Kind of did. Yeah.
Sorry about that.
I know they say if you ain't first, you're last, but if I would have been fourth, I'd have felt like I was first.
Big Dixon Energy, our good friend Floctimus Prime, pulling down the Walter Jones autographed jersey in third place.
That's pretty sweet, too. And I know Keith will do it proud, however he displays it or decides to wear it, whatever it is that Keith does with it. I'm sure it's going to be awesome.
12th Hawker Locker, Garrett in Northern Ontario, getting the Steve Largent signed football at number two.
That's awesome. He's also trying to recruit the state of Montana to come be part of Canada.
Yeah, both him and some of the other members of the Ring of Honor. Yeah, yeah. We're definitely in on that.
Yeah, I think so. I think so.
As far as our Canadian Ring of Honor members go, I don't know if there were too many folks in the U.S. who were super happy about that idea.
Yeah, but they're not seeing the second half of that. Is that the whole idea is that they'd sell Montana to Canada and then pay off the national debt.
They were a little bit low on the asking price, though.
Yeah. That was the part of that whole little Facebook post that alarmed me the most, is that somebody out there thought that $1 trillion would get it done to pay off the national debt. And you might want to check our national credit card statement because it's a little higher.
it's more in the 20s range. So, yeah.
Yeah.
Thanks to Vincent Parker for posting that initially, too, and wanting to get us up in part of Canada because, you know, the landscape's similar. The people around here in Montana are similar. I think we'd integrate well into the Canadian system.
Yeah, I think we'd assimilate. I think we would if we didn't die from their total lack of healthcare. Like somehow we'd have to survive that.
We would.
Do you think you can be a survivor of the Canadian healthcare system?
I people up there seem to do all right.
Yeah. Okay.
And I think they have some different laws in terms of some recreational substances that are a little bit different too.
Yeah. Yeah. But there would be an issue with the gun part. Like I know there's some possessions that certain people in the state have that wouldn't be lawful there.
No, that would turn it over pretty quickly, I suppose. Well, you know what? Maybe we just need to merge our two governments and maybe even merge the two names. I like the name Montanada.
Montanada? Sounds like you have a stutter, though.
A little bit.
Cantana?
There's no Cant in Montana.
That's a good point, actually.
Yeah.
There's only a Mont.
Well, we got a little bit derailed from our Pick'em League winners, but with that said, let's bring on Jesper Sacco. Jesper, all the way from Sweden, coming on the show to accept his win this season, the first place win, and the Russell Wilson signed art print. Jesper, welcome to the show. How you doing?
Hi, Brandon. I'm fine. How are you?
You know, it's fun when we go through the entire season with the Pick'em. We finally come down to a winner. And then to find out that you're all the way on the other side of the world from where we are, although probably similar weather, compared to Montana with the snow. But yeah, congrats on the big win, man.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Do you have any tips that you want to give out? Or are you going to keep that to yourself to try and win again next year?
You need to be a beginner. This is actually my first time doing this pick and thing. So just begin. Beginner's luck.
Beginner's luck. All right. Well,
that's the only tip I can give you.
I'm curious, being in Sweden, how did you get to be a Seahawks fan?
When I was young, I always watched like Frasier. Do you know the TV show Frasier?
Oh, sure. Uh-huh. Yeah.
And it's played in Seattle. The years go by and I started watch NFL, but I didn't follow any team. About the time when Seattle was beginning to be a very good team, and they showed a lot on TV in Sweden. So I started to follow Seattle, and they kind of grown on me, and with the players and Pete Carroll and everyone. Yeah, so put all the pieces together with the Frasier from Seattle. I always liked Macklemore as well, the rapper.
Uh-huh.
And then Seattle with all the characters, you know, Sherman, Russell and Doug Baldwin and Pete and everyone.
It all goes back to Frasier. That's where it started, the connection to Seattle.
Yeah.
So you get the Russell Wilson signed art print.
Yeah, that's amazing.
The custom buck knife. I think you saw that on the Facebook page. So
I saw it on the Facebook page. Yes, it's amazing. And thank you, Daniel, for donating.
Yes. So have you ever run into any other Seahawks fans over there?
Yeah, we got this Facebook group, Seattle Seahawks Sweden, that started this year. And this guy who started it just posted it on other Swedish football communities. And we're reaching about 90 members now in Sweden.
Wow.
Yeah, that's huge.
That's pretty strong.
Yeah, it is, for being in Sweden.
Well, Jesper, really want to thank you for being a listener. Really want to thank you for hanging in there through the Pick'em League this year and for not picking against the Seahawks all season.
Not at all. Not once.
Thanks to Jesper for making the connection there and coming on the show and checking in from us from Sweden.
You know, it is pretty cool just having that connection with the folks all over the globe, really, you know, and I think Jesper deserves it. Usually I would trash the winner just because it wasn't me.
Yeah.
But not this time, because I actually like Jesper.
Yeah, I admire that he's attributing his win to just beginner's luck.
Yeah, a little bit of humility. I like it. Unlike Odell Beckham Jr., he has some humility.
Yes. One of the other things that we talked about with Jesper, the fact that he wins the custom engraved knife from Buck Knives that Daniel donated.
Dude, that thing is sick.
It's like, pretty sweet.
Yeah. Can they have knives in Sweden? Is that allowed?
Yeah, I asked him. I said, I'm not going to get any trouble by shipping this to you, am I? Okay. He said, no. Right. I'll have to ask Garrett, because when he came in second place, knives have to be allowed in Canada, too. I mean, you need them up there.
If you can't kill anybody with guns, what are you going to kill them with?
I think the UK. I think that might be the one country that I have to worry about sending them to.
Yeah, maybe. I don't know.
But yes, Garrett, for coming in second place, Buck Knives, they donated a knife to the prize winner, too. And he was the member of the flock that came in at the top. So congrats to Garrett with that.
Yeah, man. Just can't say enough thanks to Daniel Weinholz and Buck Knives and all that stuff, because they beautiful, beautiful pieces of work. Each one of these. It's amazing.
I wanted to announce some other winners as part of this because, you know, we talked about giving out the top four, but I have other prizes to give away, Adam. I got some leftover stuff.
Okay. So you want to talk about winners. So that would not include the Rams per se.
Right.
Since they lost, they're losers.
I'm still flying a little high from that.
Oh yeah. I'm milking that all year.
I mean, if our team can't win, we can win by
the just, Rams losing? Yes.
Yeah, exactly.
All right. So the little Vault O Seahawks paraphernalia has been opened, and you have decided to bestow some further prizes than what we originally promised. We are overperforming here, is what I'm hearing. And you're going to give people what, fifth, sixth? How far are you going, Brandon?
Well, so what I'm going to do is I looked at it, and in the past, you know, we've looked at mid-season winners, we've looked at late-season winners, and when somebody just steamrolls all the way through the season, it just seems too extravagant to shower them with, you know, multiple really, really nice gifts.
Right.
But I was checking, and I see that, for example, Jermaine Ole, he was the winner of the first half of the season, weeks 1-10.
Yeah.
Remember saying his name quite a bit. So Jermaine Ole gets a Fanatics $25 gift card.
Oh, hell yeah, man.
I pulled up the winner of the regular season, the first 17 weeks, 1-17.
Yeah.
And Toonhawk was the one who came out on top for the first 17 weeks.
Wow. Okay. Well, congratulations to Toonhawk. What does Toonhawk get?
Frank Clark signed photo.
That was funny because you'll probably edit it out, but he started out by saying Frank Clarked. Like it was like you've been Frank Clarked, which sounds kind of terrifying. I don't want to be Frank Clarked.
No. And actually, I think the photo is of Frank Clarking somebody.
Perfect. Are we going to just change sacks to Frank Clark's?
Yeah. Yeah, see, there it is. Frank Clark, Clarking.
Is that Nick Mullins or is it Garoppolo?
It's one of the 49ers quarterbacks.
It's one of the tan 49ers quarterbacks.
So this was in Seattle.
You don't know what year, though.
No, that's true. Yeah, can't really make out the number because Frank Clark is in the process of clarking him pretty hard.
Clarking.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, now I don't have to edit that out.
Yeah, there you go. See, thanks. I'm just saving you.
You saved me. Appreciate
saving you
that,
from
man.
The work.
And finally, James Eastwood. He had the top score for weeks 11-21, which was the final week of the season. And the cool thing about him is he had been asking me all season who gets the Malik McDowell rookie card, the signed rookie card, if nobody earns it through picking against the Seahawks and finishing at top.
Correct. Yeah.
So for James, he's going to get the Malik McDowell signed rookie card.
Now that is national treasure.
It feels like it's a part of the show. Like it has no value,
intrinsic
monetary value.
No,
but it has a lot of sentimental value.
There you go. All right. Well, cool. Well, hopefully James does appreciate that.
He will. Like I said, he's been on me about saying, you know, I want this.
Oh, okay. Oh, I didn't realize like he was saying it as he wanted. He was just curious, like what's going to happen.
No, he legit said, I want that.
I need this. I like James' style. That's awesome.
So thanks to all the members of the flock. Thanks to everyone who participated in the league. While I was talking to Jesper on the phone, he said, you know, I kind of want to get in on this flock thing, but I don't want to go to getintheflock.com and do the monthly thing. I want to just do a one-time deal, get in the flock. And I said, hey, we have options for that. You can go to seahawkerspodcast.com/support. Our PayPal address is there. You know, if you have Venmo, I have the Cash App now, Adam. The Cash App sign and Hawkra is my tag name.
Okay.
And one of the cool things, I know you listen to Joe Rogan. He finally got me to bite on this whole Cash App thing.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Yeah, I listen to him. I just don't let him tell me what to do.
Well, the thing was, is I went to the Cash App website. And you could customize the debit card that they send you.
Oh, is that where you got this?
And that's where I got, I did catfish the Rams with the cat emoji and I drew a little fish and wrote out the Rams. And they sent me a debit card that says catfish the Rams on it now.
I'm sure whoever was in charge of printing that card was very confused.
What is this?
Cat? I don't know.
No.
what do catfish and Rams have all to do together?
It makes no sense as a combination, yeah. But to our little flockers, they know exactly what I'm talking about.
Yep. Posted a picture of that in the Ring of Honor. That was pretty funny.
It's true. And we have a new member of the Ring of Honor, Adam.
Really?
Yeah. Greg Carlson in at 12-12.
Ah, all right. It's about damn time, Greg.
Yeah, his wife Lisa in Seattle as a happy Valentine's Day present nice. Got him into the Ring of Honor.
That's awesome, man. Well, Merry Valentine's Day.
Lisa emails in and says, hey guys, today is Valentine's Day, and what a better day to take the next step in my relationship with my wonderful husband, Greg Carlson, by signing him up to get in the flock. I'm sharing the bounty of my truest loved ones, the Seahawks, and the wonderful Ring of Honor community. Go Hawks! From Lisa in Seattle.
Go Hawks, Lisa. That's hilarious, number one. And then I really love the idea that bringing them into the Seahawkers podcast Ring of Honor is another step in evolution of their relationship, like over marriage.
Right. Well, you know, after you've been together for a while, like, you have to start thinking of things, like, especially those of us who can't afford matching Mercedes, like Russell Wilson and Sierra, like matching Ring of Honor memberships. Now, that's something that's probably more in the wheelhouse for most of us.
Right. And requires less maintenance.
And you don't have to go back and forth with your Instagram posts on, you know, your lovey dovey emotional things that you have to put out to the entire world. No, dude, you just send an email to the show.
They need to get a little more in-house. Like, that's too much out in the public, dude.
I had a problem with that. Yeah. Okay. If I had to do better this week, it would be for Russell Wilson and Ciara.
I didn't watch it, to be clear. I just knew that that was not good.
I knew that I didn't want to watch it.
Right.
But I read what they said to one another. I said, yeah, okay. I don't need to see that.
I mean, I'm really happy that they're happy, right?
Oh, for sure.
Right. But I'm on a need to know basis, I think, and I don't need to know any of that.
Well, and I think, you know, you're with me and even my wife, you know, we're not demonstrative in how we show our affection. So when we see that, like, mm-hmm. out in the wild, that's just too much.
Yeah. Like me and my daughter, like when we're out in public.
Yeah.
So, you know how in the Princess Diaries, like, or the Princess Bride,
yeah.
Wesley, instead of saying, I love you, would say, as you wish.
Right.
I look at my daughter and I say, I don't like you very much. And she says, I don't like you either. And then we move about our day. That's how we handle that in public.
As you know, that seems more about my speed.
Yeah. I get some weird looks from some parents now and then when I just look at her and be like, hey, like she'll be walking away. Hey, I don't like you. She's like, good. I don't like you either. I was like, bye.
That's other people's problem.
Yeah.
They don't need to get you.
Sorry, they're not in on the code.
An email that came in says you need to give a Better at Life segment to NFL Films for the YouTube video, The Art of the Get Back Coach. I do this. I'm in the Ring of Honor. Pokemon Go hating and all, Adam and Brandon. Betty White is an Osprey. And if one of you don't, you'll get a Rain City Bitch Pigeons review on iTunes. Yes.
Oh, man.
I'm holding you hostages. But you will either get a Ring of Honor member or a 5-star review full of hate. Your choice. Bring on the fire emojis.
We do not negotiate with terrorists.
I think with Paul in St. Louis, maybe we do need to negotiate in terms of with terrorists, or he needs to tune in and find out if in fact we will negotiate.
Okay, so this is what I think we need to do with Paul in St. Louis. Let's do the segment as a request, but I kind of want the review with like all of the like hilarious non-hate and fire emojis and. You know, that sort of thing.
Oh, so you want both?
I kind of want to treat it as a roast.
Well, you know what? I think in Paul's case, for one, he needs to do better and realize that we already have a level at getintheflock.com where you can pitch your idea of a Better at Life at the $25 level. So I say we either don't let him in the Ring of Honor.
Okay.
If he only does 12. Uh-huh. Until he gets the 5-star review in.
Okay.
If he does the $25 level as he should,
yes.
then that allows him to escape having to do the review to get in.
I like it.
See, now we're negotiating back with terms.
I feel like I just talked with the FBI or something. That was really smooth by you. Was it Samuel L. Jackson in a movie like The Negotiator, something like that? I feel like I just...
We said at the end of the field goals episode, we needed to watch The Negotiator. And that's, I think, what I learned. That you can, in fact, negotiate. And we'll see how this works out from here.
Well, hopefully Paul doesn't take us all down. Get in the flock, you freeloader.
Getintheflock.com. We will continue to keep that going as we stash away all the field goals money that we're bringing in from moving over there.
I'm going to be sleeping on a mattress, just stuff filled or, you know, just stuff full of pennies.
Yeah, that's going to be a tiny mattress.
That's all right.
When we got into this, it was for the fun of talking to one another every week. That was the goal.
Well, yeah. And I mean, the whole idea, too, of just doing this with field goals is just so that, again, we get more exposure. Try to grow the show. Just do something a little different.
Yeah. It's been 6 years. Let's try things a little bit differently.
Sometimes, you know, once you get to that 6-7 year mark in a relationship, you got to spice things up.
Spice it up.
Yeah.
John Davison emails in, says, well, I just watched Super Bowl 53. I know you call it Super Bowl, but frankly, it wasn't that super. I stayed up until 3:45 a.m. Monday morning to watch that.
Yeah, that wasn't worth it, John. I'm sorry.
I must be mad. Barry sat next to me, agreed. The whole thing was crap from start to finish, and don't even get me started about the halftime show. That was worse. When this fat bloke in the fur coat came on, I knew I was old. I also knew he was going to be shite, and he was. The whole thing was 3 hours of my life that I'll never get back. Ah, well, on to the draft, I guess. I've been thinking about what we need and found Rob Staton very informative and a great help. Andy's a Brit. I reached the conclusion that any position would be welcome, so don't mind a D-line, O-line, a receiver, or a cornerback, but I guess we'll trade down as normal. Go Hawks! From John Davison. P.S. Gutted to be fifth in the pick'ems and just out of the prizes, but congrats to the winner.
You didn't give John a prize after that?
You know what? I just announced it. He's the one getting the Frank Clark autograph photo, so this will be news to him now.
Oh, well, lucky for John.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, John, you can't get that time back in your life, but you can't take solace in the fact that the Rams had to suck it and lose, and so that wasn't too bad.
You can be happy that happened, but knowing that you never get that time back, like, that's legit sleep time that he missed out on.
Yeah, in the middle of the night. Like, I watched it during the middle of the day. That, okay, fine. But, like, watching it in the middle of the night. And, look, I want to share John's sentiment, or really, I want America to share in John's sentiment about the halftime show. I think all of America agreed.
And it wasn't great. I just don't know if it was as bad as people are going on about.
It was just legit boring.
Yeah, the halftime show matched the game.
Yes, indeed.
It wasn't anything exciting.
Yeah.
You know, was it Lady Gaga that came down, like, jumped in through the rafters?
Yeah. And then there was, like, 1 year Katy Perry, like, rode in on, like, a giant mechanical lion or some crap. Yeah.
See, at least those had, you know, moments.
I don't know. Some people will say that, like, meteor thing that came down was supposed to be cool.
Oh, well, that was a cartoon. And then didn't it just...
I don't know. I was trying not to fall asleep.
Well, hopefully people aren't falling asleep in this show, but BJ Pester emails in. Sounds like this isn't one that he sleeps through, because he says, so good. 5 stars. Disappointed about the Super Bowl teams. Go Seahawks. You guys are my favorite NFL podcast. And he asks, how many Hawks games have you been to?
Oh, well, thank you for the review, first and foremost, BJ. That always helps. It definitely does. And we'll need a lot of that in field goals as well. Now that we're starting up there,
they've started to come in.
Yeah, they have. But we're going to need a lot more.
Yeah.
Like, if you like helping us out, like, say you're a freeloader, which is fine. Like, I'm not even mad at you. That's a way you can help out, like, for free.
Tell your friends, review the show.
Yeah.
Send in emails of things that we should talk about in the off season.
Yes, please. How many Seahawks games have you been to, Brandon?
I was trying to count it up. Well, you know, I growing up in Seattle, my first game, and I've been trying to figure out which one my very first game was. It was, I either saw a Saints game or a Raiders game, and it was in the 1988-1987 time frame. Wow. And that was when my dad took me, and I think we sat behind, it was probably the south end zone in the very last row of the stadium. In the 300 level.
Yeah.
I remember that pretty distinctly.
Right.
So it was either the Raiders or the Saints where I saw that. And since then, I don't know, between 20 and 30, maybe.
Yeah. I was going to say it's got to be up there at least. Right.
Yeah.
I don't know. What about me? I'm probably like, what, like 6 or 7, 5 or 6.
You're probably getting close to double digits, I would think.
Yeah. Somewhere in there.
Yeah.
I mean, are we counting preseason games?
Those count as games, don't they? I mean, trips to the stadium is a trip to the stadium.
Right, but it still doesn't count as a game per se. It doesn't go on the record.
You count postseason.
Yeah, but those count.
Okay.
But well. I'll tell you what, I'll count the London game as like 3 and take the preseason ones off.
Okay, there you go.
Because like going to another country to do it, like I felt like that was...
That takes some work.
And it was awesome.
Yeah, I've definitely been fortunate over the years, especially since the 1 year that I had season tickets that I probably went to more games than any other was in 1999, the last year of the Kingdom. I went to probably four or five games that year. And then got to see Seattle play a few times over on the East Coast, where they always lost.
That was fun. Glad we fixed that.
Yeah, Pete Carroll's gotten us over 500 in terms of franchise wins now.
Wow.
Or in terms of the 500 right. The winning percentage. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm picking up what you're putting down.
Okay. Just want to make sure I get that right.
Yeah.
All right, Adam. Well, what do you say we move on to Better at Life and find out if Paul gets what he wants?
Shout out to Jalen Rose once again. You got to give the people what they want.
Better at Life this week to NFL Films for the video of the art of the Get Back Coach. It was an incredible video. And in terms with the theme of this show and talking to the guys with the Rams podcast, I have to say that the fact that the video featured Sean McVay as being the worst offender in the NFL of not being able to stay on the sideline,
have any spatial awareness whatsoever as a freaking adult.
Yeah. The timing of the video was perfect. And it led to a lot of memes online of the Get Back Coach, like pulling back the Lombardi trophy during the Super Bowl. That was kind of fun.
That's pretty funny. I didn't see that one.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. It led to a lot of good moments. And you just mentioned it, Adam, the idea that a grown man, Sean McVay, needs to be babysat and followed around by another grown man who has the specific duty of pulling him back on the sideline every time he wanders toward the field. Yes. I can't believe that a human, especially of the intelligence of Sean McVay, he's a smart guy. We can agree to that he's that oblivious. I hope that he recognizes how bad the optics are, that he can finally figure it out and know where he can and can't walk on the sideline.
Can you imagine what a nightmare he was in like grade school? Like when everybody's like, stand in a line and walk over to the bus. And like, there's Sean, like, you know, going down the slide head first and like, you know, doing cartwheels and has no idea what's going on.
That was like
5 years ago, by the way.
Right. I blame his grade school teachers for not putting him on a leash back in his grade school days.
Yeah. Like 2008.
That would have fixed that.
Yeah.
Because look at the other adults that were featured in that short film. Look at Mike Tomlin. Look at Sean Payton. Right. Those guys were both featured in the video, but they didn't have another person hanging on their waist the whole time.
What kind of an ego do you have if you're like, yeah, I can't be bothered to like control my own body. I'm going to need you to do that for me.
I'm going to need you to babysit me and grab me by the waist to pull me back when I start to wander toward the sideline, wander toward the field.
So I kind of feel like it's a Better at Life for the people that put together the video, right?
Uh-huh.
But it's also kind of a do better for Sean McVay. So is it a do better at life?
You know what? It could be. But I'm going to say full on Better at Life. The fact that the video made McVay look like the biggest tool bag in the NFL. And it wasn't
the hair.
That was part of it, too.
He looks like he could be a member of NSYNC.
For sure. Yeah. And it was just what I needed leading up to the Super Bowl. So for that, NFL Films, you are better at life than Skip Bayless.
I like it.
Show me the money, Paul.
Pay up.
And next month, Paul, as we thank our monthly subscribers at 12 and above, you too can be a part of this list. Let's kick it off. So dumb.
Keith Kedover, a.k.a. Flocktimus Prime, University of Cybertron, Little Flockers, roll out.
DCH from Sparks, Nevada, the University of Montana Grizzlies.
Annalisa Mickelson, a.k.a. Mrs. Doug Baldwin, New York, New York, undergrad, University of North Carolina, Greensboro, graduate school, Brooklyn College.
Eric Trench, rooting for the Seahawks out of Renton, Washington, graduated from Eastern Washington University.
Gary Blum from Chappaqua, New York and the University of Pennsylvania, your 2016 Pick'em League champion.
Ron Pepper, UNLV Runnin' Rebels, San Francisco, California.
David Bloomquist, Hong Kong Hawk. Ma Sheng Yi Shu She Ye.
Kevin Sedgham, Keen Kuiper.
Ella Esparza, Woodway, Texas, Yale University, and Sam Houston State, Eat 'em Up Cats.
Lisa in Seattle,
Sam Sullivan from the wonderful land of Oz, the Jorge State University.
Paul from San Diego.
Vincent Parker, Emily Carr University of Art Design, RN Collective.
Hector Delgadillo from Los Angeles, California.
Samuel Jackson Gelber, the Pasadena City College.
David Van Cleve, Camas, Washington, home of the Papermakers.
Mark in Kirrup, Western Australia, aka My Water Spins Backwards. Farmer, didn't finish high school.
Garrett Strongbanks, Northern Ontario, Georgian College.
Jamison Holman from Murray, Utah, representing Mississippi State University. Hail State and go Hawks.
And we continue to thank our monthly supporters, starting with those on PayPal, John W. in New York, Paul in Minneapolis, Pepper in Greenville, South Carolina, Seth in Tacoma, and Don in the Pacific Northwest. Also at 12 and above via getintheflock.com. We got Ross in Eureka, California, Christina in Manassas, Virginia, Sven in Berlin, Deutschland, James in Linwood, Roe in Federal Way, Summer in Vancouver, Hector in Issaquah, Kevin in Snohomish, Young in Anchorage, Alaska, Becca in Manhattan Beach, California, Tim in Austin, John Paul in Palmer, Alaska, Kathy in Eureka, California, Joshua in London, Brandon in Winston-Salem, North Carolina, Christian in Bergen, Norway, David in Moore, South Carolina, Jonathan in Ridgefield, Craig in Pasco, Thomas in the Bronx, Len in Sanford, Florida, Jared in Missoula, Montana, Hector in Van Nuys, California, Leland in West Jordan, California, Keegan in Colorado Springs, John in Pearson, Nebraska, Taylor in Federal Way, Owen in Ashburn, Ireland, Kari in Rochester, Jeff in Waddell, Arizona, Michael in Tucson, Arizona, Brian in Berlin, Connecticut, Gary in Kaneohe, Hawaii, Eric in Seattle, Tracy in Kaneohe, Hawaii, Connie in Gothenburg, Sweden, Max in Honolulu, Taylor in South Cleveland, Ryan in Sugarland, Texas, Dean in the Greater Hockdom, Marvin in Riverdale, Utah, Brian in Greater Hockdom, JC in Billericay, UK, Lisa in Kelowna, BC, Scott in Fresno, California, Eric in Clovis, California, Bryson in Eltopia, Shannon in Florida, Aaron in Frederick, Maryland, John C. in the Greater Hockdom, Andrew in Marysville, Shoko in New York, and Greg in Seattle. And with that,
there's only one thing left to say.
Go Hawks.
Go Hawks.